Again, I am glad that you are here this morning. You know, it's good to gather together. The New Testament actually says to not miss out on the opportunity to do that. And there's just something when we're gathered together, just a special, God's always with us, but there's a special sense of God's presence when we're gathered together. And we get together, we spur each other on, you know, to live like Jesus, to do good in our world. So it's a good thing. I also know that there are people who are not able to do that or cannot do that this morning. So I just want to take a minute, if that's okay, just to welcome those of you who are watching online. And you maybe it was the weather or some other reason you're not able to be here today, but I'm glad that you're watching, that you are engaging with us. And if you're watching on Facebook, you can share that, and that's how you can be a part of the mission and participate in the mission. Our building is here in Colony, but our mission is to make Jesus famous throughout the capital region. And so we do that in a number of ways. And so thank you for being part of that. Anywhere you're watching or listening, thank you. Welcome. It is so good for us to be able to get together and to talk about Jesus. Amen. Right on? Amen. Right on. Good stuff. Today we are going to look at the story of Lazarus. Once again, if you were here with us on Easter, you know that we saw this. We looked at this story from the perspective of Jesus. Today we're going to look at it from the perspective of Lazarus himself. This story is found in the New Testament. It's the ultimate comeback story. If you're not familiar with the story of Lazarus, he was dead, and then Jesus brought him back to life. So that's a pretty good comeback. Would you agree? And Jesus brought him back to life, and he went on to live after that. And his story says something to us about our own, the potential of our own comeback story. So we're going to look at that. You know, there are a lot of events that happen to us in life, and most events, most things that happen to us, they just kind of come and go. They happen, and then they just kind of fade away into, you know, wherever memories go. But then there are some events. There are some events that are so big that they live on past the moment, and they become stories. And those stories, they live on and they live in us, and they end up shaping the lives of all who experience them. And they even have the power to give life to those who hear them. And the story of Lazarus is definitely one of those. And you, each of you here, have one of those stories, many of those stories as well. And you may not believe that. You may not realize that. You may not have ever thought about that. But it's true. What has shaped your life has the power to be life-giving to others. And that's why we have started Capital Stories. And so you can go right there to capitalstories.org and you can share your story. And what we're doing is we're looking to collect people's stories and to allow them, there's a number of prompts there, or you can write from scratch, to allow them to do what stories do. And that's encourage people to believe that as what God has done in your life, God can also do in mine. And this week we began to receive some stories, and if you wrote in yours, thank you. We received some amazing stories. I mean, heartbreaking stories, beautiful stories. Stories of incredible rescue and restoration and redemption. Stories that are powerful, that are going to bring life to all who read them. And we're not putting them out yet. We're going to put them out in about a month after we collect more. I believe that there are so many more stories here in this room. You know, sometimes we downplay the value and the importance of our own story. We keep it to ourselves. We think, no one's gonna care about that. No one's gonna want to hear that. I've told so many people that story. But the truth is that the more personal the story, the more universally relevant it is. Because one thing that every person can relate to is what's real. And so I want to encourage you to go on this site. Go to capitalstories.org today. Do it this week and write your story. There's a place on there that you can start writing it and then say, well, I'm not done. I'm going to submit it and come back to it later. You can hit that button. There's all kinds of privacy settings that I put on there because I want to remove every obstacle that I could think of. And so you can go and you can tell us if you want to write, if you want to include your name, if you want to be anonymous. You can tell us where we can use it, it and how we can use it. And when you submit that story, just so you know, when you hit that submit button, where does that go? That goes directly to me. No one else sees that. That comes directly to, I'm the only one that sees that. You can even submit the story without even me knowing who submitted that story. And you can do that as well. But I just wanted to remove all that so you can feel empowered to do that, because I think that it's really so important. Because you have that story, like Lazarus' story, that has that power to bring life. When we talk about Lazarus' story, what's funny about Lazarus' story, and this is probably unlike yours, I don't know, but in Lazarus' story, it's his story, but he's like hardly in it, right? Like 95% of his story, he's dead. And even when he does step on stage, he doesn't get any lines. Maybe you're feeling actually that's exactly like my story. That's what I feel like every day. But that's Lazarus' story. Nevertheless, what he has is a great comeback story, because he gets another chance at life. How many of you wouldn't love that? How many of you are here today? Wow. Let me try to. How many of you are here today? That was the easiest one. I couldn't think of an easier one. How many of you are here today? How many of you would love another chance at life? Maybe you know what I'm talking about. Another chance at something that, and you don't have to say what it is or raise your hand, but maybe there's something you messed up at. Another chance at what you missed out on because you didn't fully appreciate it when it was there. You didn't take full advantage of it, you know, make full use of it when you had the chance. Maybe a relationship or an opportunity something else that God had put in front of you that you had a good path that you were on. The question, though, that I want to ask today is, what would you do with another chance? Because I know that if I were to come up with a list of the things that I would like another chance at, I could fill notebooks with it. Does anyone else feel that way at all? Actually, I took time to kind of think about it this week, and where I settled was on the 20s. Like, I like to do the 20s over. Not the 1920s, I mean my 20s. I mean like an entire decade, like all 10 years, I would just like to do it just completely over, because what I wasn't messing up in that time, I was missing out on because I wasn't fully appreciating it. And I'm talking about college, I'm talking about the first years of marriage, first years of being a parent, first jobs, relationships with my friends, with my family, my relationship with God, how I responded to certain challenges and tragedies that I faced during that time, the way I responded to opportunities that were put right in front of me. I'm telling you, I'm not exaggerating, all of it. I didn't get any of it right. I mean, I got lucky, right, in a couple occasions. I married an amazing wife, right, and I have great kids. But I messed up and I missed out on even those relationships all throughout those years. I would love to have another chance at all of it. Of course, there's some things you don't get a second chance on. You just get one chance. And the story that you write in that chance is the story. But sometimes, by the grace of God, a comeback is possible. Sometimes another chapter can be written with a whole new ending. You with me on that? Do you believe that? Do you believe that's true for you? The story of Lazarus suggests that it is true for each of us. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to look at this story and we're going to see three things, okay? The first thing we're going to see is why you're thinking that it's not possible for you. Because I saw it in your eyes, right? And I heard it in your response. Yeah, I believe that's true. We're gonna see in that story why you are thinking right now that it is not possible for you. You're thinking about, Pastor, that sounds nice, but you don't know how much I've messed up. You don't know how badly I missed out. We're gonna talk about that. So the first thing we're going to look at is why you doubt that this is possible for you. The second thing we're going to see is why I believe that it absolutely is possible And number three, we're going to look at how you can do what you can do with another chance, how you can do something great with another chance once it's given. You with me? So why you don't believe it, why I believe it's true for you, and how you can do something great with another chance when you get it. All right, so I'm just really glad that you're here today. I think that this is a message that really speaks to all of us. I imagine, I wouldn't be surprised, maybe there's something that has taken a little bit of life out of you, a little bit out of you. Maybe you would kind of tag it like your biggest disappointment. I really believe that it can be the seed of your biggest comeback story. And whether you're here and you're saying, listen, I'm in that second chance right now, I'm starting out, or you would say, listen, I think all my second chances, all my new chances are over, I believe that God has something to say to you today, and I believe that we're going to walk away with something that you can apply tomorrow, okay? So John chapter 11, if you have your Bibles or your phones, you can look that up. You can go on the Bible app and find our event. In the live event, you can follow along. You can also open up your worship guide, and there's a weekly there. You can follow along the notes there, and there'll be stuff on the screen behind me as well. Like I said, Lazarus was dead for just about all of his story, so why don't we pick up where he comes onto the scene. John chapter 11, verse 38. Here's what we read. Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, take away the stone. And then Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time, there will be a bad odor, for he has been dead 4 days. Here is why you don't believe that what I'm saying is possible for you. Martha's not like giving Jesus a lesson on how bodies decompose, right? She's revealing some real doubts that you may feel yourself. The first thing is this. Martha knows what you probably know too. Death stinks. Death stinks, and that stink, it rubs off on those who have died, who have experienced that death. You with me? I'm being metaphorical here, but maybe you know what I'm talking about. If you have ever experienced the death of, let's say, the death of a dream, maybe the death of an important relationship, the death of your marriage, maybe the death of a career or a path that you were on, then you know that that death stinks, but you also know that it tends to leave an odor on you, so to speak, like regret and anger and bitterness. Hurt, self-hatred, distrust, shame. And others may not know as you move from that point, others may not know exactly all of the details, but they can tell, right? Something's not right. Because those things are unpleasantly noticeable. They deteriorate who you really are. And they negatively affect the way you interact with your world. So you may be doubting and maybe saying to yourself, look, I've been so messed up by how I messed up. God is not going to give me another chance. I could not be used again. Martha also knows something else. She knows that waiting makes the hope grow fainter. One day, 2 days, maybe she's thinking, hey, she's got hope for the miraculous for her brother, but 4 days? Maybe you've experienced this too, you know. You miss out on something, some chance for something great, and you regret that, but you still have hope that you're going to get another chance. Another chance will come down the road until it doesn't. And then time passes. And the longer that you are in that waiting place, the fainter your hope grows that there's ever going to be another chance coming your way. So maybe you're here and maybe you're doubting and you're saying, Pastor, look, I missed out on my chance and you don't realize how long it's been. Clearly God must have moved on from me. Now, I don't know if either of those fit into your category, if that's why you would doubt maybe that this is possible for you. But I believe a great comeback is possible for you, and here's why. Jesus said this to Martha. He responded to her when she said this. He said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? Now, just before this, he was speaking to her and he told her this. He said, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And then he asks her, he says, do you believe this? And he was telling her two things. He was telling her, yes, look, I will bring you to life on that last day. That is the hope of heaven. And thank God for that hope. But he's telling her also, I have come here to bring life to you here and now. A full and abundant, rich and satisfying, real kind of life. A God-connected, God-led, more and better life than you can ever imagine. And he's telling her, look, I have come to bring you this life, and here's how you step into that life. The way into that is through faith in me, is by believing in who I say I am, believing in what I am able to do. And so now here in verse 40, he's asking her again in front of the tomb. He's saying, hey, Martha, same question. Do you believe? Because if you will believe, if you will trust, you will see the life-giving, life-restoring power and brilliance and beauty of God at work, displayed not only in what I'm about to do in this other chance at life that I'm going to give Lazarus, but you're going to see this also in how I give all people the chance at a new kind life. See, folks, this is the gospel. I don't know here if you're a follower of Jesus or not, if you're considering it or you've ruled it out, but this is the true message of Christianity, that Jesus brings new life. That he went to the cross and he rose from the dead to overcome real death, to show us that there's no kind of death in this life that he cannot also overcome. That he can make all together new. You may be here and you may be doubting that there's any comeback possible for you because you feel like you have been too infected by your past, that the stench of your loss and your mistakes are all over you, and that's what's keeping you from moving forward. You may be doubting your comeback story because you feel like it's just been too long and all of your hope has faded. But I believe that it is possible for every single person because Jesus says, look, if you will believe, then you will see the glory of God. And we talk about the glory of God. I'm telling you that the glory of God is able to outshine the darkest past in this room. Amen. The glory of God is able to breathe life into the most suffocating shame. The glory of God is able to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. It's able to heal every single one of your wounds. It's even able to restore wasted time. Do you believe this? If you will believe it, you will see it happen in your life. And that's why I believe that it is true for you. So let's say Jesus gives you another chance. The question remains, what do you do with it? How will you do something great with it? Well, here's the rest of Lazarus' story. Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And so the man who died came out. His hands and his feet were bound with linen strips, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to the crowd around them, you unbind him and let him go. I love that commercial for community groups because it's so true. Jesus will bring life to you, but he uses the community. Not that he can't do it, he chooses to use the community in order to help you find freedom. That's why community groups are so important here. It's why we make such an emphasis of it, and we drive it all the time. It's why I say literally with all of my heart that I want every single one of you to be involved in a community group. If you are not in one, join one. You can just show up. Just show up this week, and I promise you everyone will be so happy that you are there. John goes on here, and he tells us that Lazarus is mentioned maybe a few more times. The Passover, there's a Passover. Jesus leaves the area for a while. But then the Passover comes, and so they come back into town. And so Jesus comes back into town, and so they gave him a dinner there. And Martha served at this dinner, and we read, we find that Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at the table. So we discover that Lazarus, he followed Jesus after this. He lived in the community of believers, and he took that opportunity of this new life to draw close to Jesus. John then tells us that when a large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. Now this guy Lazarus, who's never mentioned before, who we don't even know, people want to see him. Why? Because they want to see the work that Jesus has done in him. When people find out and they see the work that has been the changed life, they are now attracted to that. So they want to see what Jesus has done. But watch what happens here. The chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well. I mean, how do you like that, right? He's only been alive again for a minute, and now people want to kill him already, right? They want to kill him as well because they want to kill Jesus. This is something that Jesus tells us. Look, you're going to have people who are, you're trying to live like Jesus, and this is true. If you're a Christian, you should know this. If you're deciding whether or not to be a follower of Jesus, you should know this. If you're going to be a follower of Jesus in this world, like more than just, I do something a little bit different on Sunday mornings. But I mean, like you're going to allow Jesus to shape your life, and you're going to begin to live like Jesus in this world. You're going to have people who are drawn to you. People want to see this change, this transformation that's happening in you. You're also going to have people who are offended by you, people who don't like you. I mean, Jesus told his followers this. And he didn't say it's an either or. If you do it right, it'll work this way. If you do it wrong, it'll work that way. He says, look, both of these things are going to happen. If you live like me in this world, you're going to be salt and light in this world. And there's going to be people who are drawn to you, and they're going to love you for making things better and brighter. You're also going to be persecuted and hated, because light shows things as they are, and not everyone wants to see things like that. And so you're going to have friends, and you're going to have enemies. Lazarus, he experienced, he had people who wanted, hey man, all of a sudden you became cool because of what Jesus did in your life. But you had other people who wanted to kill him. Why? Because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. Check that out. People were being drawn to faith in Jesus because they were seeing the change in Lazarus. Well, John tells us then a little bit later that the crowd that had been with them when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. In other words, this group of people that saw this miracle, this change that happened in Lazarus' life, not only were they attracted to Lazarus, not only were they influenced towards faith in Jesus, but they were also inspired to go out and start telling others about Jesus. You see, that's the ripple effect of a comeback story. That's the power that your story has. When people know about the transformation that Jesus makes in our lives, it will influence them towards faith in him, and it will send them out talking about him to others. That's why your story is so important for you to share. Now, Lazarus is not mentioned again in the rest of the New Testament. How many of you remember VH1? If you're my age, you remember VH1 used to do these Where Are They Now specials. Anybody remember that? And so what those were is they'd find people who were, you know, famous for just a little bit, and then they just kind of slipped out, you know, of the public eye, and they would send their researchers and track down, you know, where they were and how many pounds they gained and how broke they were and all that kind of stuff like that. Well, VH1, they never did a special on Lazarus, so I don't know if you thought that's where it was going, but during a certain period of time, there was the church was really into answering this question: where are they now, or where did they go? What happened to them next? For a lot of the legends of the New Testament, so one of the traditions, the Eastern Orthodox tradition, they kind of tracked Lazarus down this way. They say that Lazarus, because they were trying to kill him, he and his sisters, they fled out of Judea, out of that area, and they went north to this island called Cyprus, which is in the Mediterranean. And while he was there, he was in some way a part of growing the church and building the church and spreading the message of Jesus there. And then Paul and the Apostle Paul and Barnabas, they appointed Lazarus to be the bishop over all of the churches in Cyprus. And even the Virgin Mary came and for the induction ceremony and put the mantle over his neck. And then he lived there for 30 years after that until he died for the last time. I don't know if that's true or not. There is a stone in Cyprus that says, "Here lies Lazarus, friend of Christ." So that's pretty cool, just that that's what you're known for. I like that. It'd be funny if it said, "Here lies Lazarus, finally, friend of Christ," right? But that's different. There's another tradition that says that Lazarus floated in a boat without oars all the way to France, and then he got beheaded by Romans, and then the church took his head, and it's a sacred relic that they have hidden away somewhere. Not as cool of a story, so I don't know which one it is. Here's what we do know. Lazarus got another chance at life, and he didn't deserve it. He didn't earn it. He didn't do anything to get it. It's just something that Jesus gave to him. And we know that with that other chance, what we do know that he did, is that he lived in the community with followers of Jesus. And he did take every opportunity that he had, at least, to draw close to Jesus. And what we do know about Lazarus is that because of the change that happened in his life, those who knew about it, they were drawn to him, they were influenced towards faith in Jesus, and they were inspired to tell others of the story about Jesus as well. Here's what we know. A changed life will change lives. That's the ripple effect of your own comeback story. So what do we do with this? The gospel is this. The good news is this, that Jesus brings life. You'll hear Christians talking about salvation. We talk about being saved and salvation. That's the ultimate comeback story. That's the story that when we put our faith in Jesus, we are rescued or saved from a dead life disconnected from God, moving in a trajectory away from God forever. And when we are saved from that life, God gives us his Spirit. He brings us into a new life. Our sins are forgiven, and his Spirit lives with us and guides us in this life towards becoming like Jesus and living out a life of purpose that he intends for us on a trajectory towards being with God forever. That kind of that comeback story is described in the Bible as being like from dead to life, from going from darkness to life. That's the ultimate comeback story. In fact, all of your life until you step into a relationship with Jesus, all of your life is a long story about you coming to find and know Jesus. But once you do begin your relationship with Jesus, the rest of your story is all about how your changing life has the power to change lives. And see, one of the most beautiful thing about the real Christian message is that it's not just simply about that time when you say, okay, Jesus, I'm going to accept you as my Savior, and then I'm going to wait out life until heaven. One of the most beautiful things about the gospel is that he brings life to us here and now. That as a follower of Jesus, he is always giving us new chances in this life. Do you know that? I mean, Jesus is always bringing new chances within life. I mean, new relationships, right? All new friends, sometimes new marriages, or forgiveness within your marriage is like a brand new start. Sometimes you'll be moved into a new town, and you'll enter into a new church community, a new job, a new school. Jesus gives new life when he brings healing to your illnesses. He gives you new chances when he brings you freedom from your addictions. I mean, every Monday is a new chance by the grace of God to get it right this week. Are you with me? The question is, what will we do with all of these new chances we're given? How do we stop telling the same sad story with the same bad ending every new chance we get? How do we live the kind of comeback story that people are attracted to, that influences people towards Jesus, that sends people out talking about Jesus because of what they've seen in you? How do we do something great with the new chances we've been given? I just want to leave you with three things, just three ideas. They're what I've learned, what I'm learning, and what I'm working out in my own life. Number one, if you want to do something great with the new chances that you're given, do something grateful. Start with something grateful. The Apostle Paul is like the ultimate example of doing something great with his new chance, right? I mean, the Apostle Paul planted churches all across the Roman Empire. He advanced Christianity. He is, I don't even think, arguably, the greatest missionary of all time. But here's how Paul saw the story. He said, he was writing to someone that he was discipling. He said, "I am so grateful to Christ Jesus for making me adequate to do this work. He went out on a limb, you know, entrusting me with this ministry. The only credentials I brought to it were blasphemy and witch hunts and arrogance. But I was treated mercifully because I didn't know what I was doing and didn't know who I was doing it against. Grace mixed with faith and love poured over me and into me, and all because of Jesus." Here's a word you can take to heart and depend on. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. I'm proof, public sinner number one, of someone who could never have made it apart from sheer mercy. And now he shows me off, evidence of his endless patience to those who are right on the edge of trusting him forever. Look, if you want to tell a great comeback story with your life, then approach your new life with extreme gratitude, with extreme humility. Those are the antidote for the poison of entitlement. You know what I mean? Those are the things that will wash away the stink of arrogance. If you've gotten a new chance, it's because you received mercy, probably both from God and from other people. So start from gratitude. Walk into every room saying to yourself, "I don't deserve to be here, but I'm so glad I am." If you want to do something great, start grateful. Number two, if you want to do something great, do something different. You've heard the expression before, the quote, "Insanity is repeating the same mistakes and expecting different results." You've heard this before, right? Well, whether or not it's really a useful definition of insanity, I don't know. But it is true, we can agree, that making the same mistakes over and over again and expecting that it's going to turn out differently, well, it's at least stupid, right? Yeah, the Apostle Paul, he said this. He said, look, he said, as long as you did what you felt like doing, ignoring God, you didn't have to bother with right thinking or right living or right anything for that matter. But do you call that a free life? What did you get out of it? Nothing you're proud of now. Where did it get you? A dead end. Look, if you want a different end, you need to do something different. If you don't break patterns, those patterns are going to repeat. That's what patterns do. They're built to repeat. If you want to be unbound, you have to set new boundaries. We know all this, right? But knowing it doesn't really matter, does it? It's like Jesus said, "It's only those who both know and do what I say who will be successful." Christianity, contrary to negative opinion, is not a list of don'ts. If it's a list of anything, it's a list of do insteads. Paul goes on to say, now that you've found that you don't have to listen to sin tell you what to do, and you have discovered the delight of listening to God telling you what to do, What a surprise! A whole, healed, put together life right now, with more and more of life on the way. I made a comeback in my marriage when I discovered the delight of saying you first instead of me first. I made a comeback with my kids when I discovered the delight of just loving them rather than instead of trying to fix them. I always knew that was the right thing to do, but then I started doing it. If you want to do something great with your new chance, do something different. If you want to do something great, number three, then do something difference-making. Jesus gave us a whole new definition of greatness. He said serve. He said serve everyone. He said be humble and serve others. True greatness, he showed us, was to make a positive difference in the life of someone else. And it's true. You will never be fulfilled. You will always feel like you're missing out on something until you are doing that, making a difference in the life, a positive difference in the life of someone else. That's why we do the Grow Plan here. The Grow Plan, you've heard me talk about it possibly before. It's all about helping you to get onto the serve team, to be able to use what you're good at and what you like doing for the sake of making a difference in other people's lives here at Capital for the name and the mission of Jesus. Today, as a matter of fact, is step three. It runs every week, but today's step three, and step three is the most fun of all of the steps. It's where you get to discover your personality and your spiritual gifts, the way that God has wired you to make a difference. And even if you've never done the Grow Plan or never even heard of the Grow Plan before, you can do that today, where you can discover how God has wired you to make a difference in other people's lives. When you discover your design, that's when you begin to discover the destiny that God has for you. See, getting on the serve team for you, I don't know, it may be your next step towards making a difference. Maybe you're on the serve team, though. The thing is this, the most difference-making thing that you'll ever do is allowing God to make a difference in you. Because it's a changed life that will change lives. And a changed life happens, it's the result of taking next steps on your spiritual journey. And your most important step, my most important step, is the next step you will take. The next step I will take. There's always a list. You'd have to really try hard to avoid the list of potential next steps here at Capital. Because they're on your weekly, they're on the app, they're on the further card, they're on our live event, our Bible app. And why do we put those things, these steps in all of these places? Because you see, Jesus brings life. We don't have anything to do with that. Jesus brings life to us. He gives us new chances in life all of the time. The question is, what do we do with those new chances? My prayer for you, my prayer for me, is that we won't mess up or miss out on another chance to do something great with this new life that Jesus has given us. My prayer for you is that you won't miss this chance. That you won't miss your chance to be changed, to be transformed, to let God do a new work in your life. You know what? Maybe God has already been speaking to you about what that is for you. I want to pray, I'm going to be praying that you will have the courage to take that next step today. The good message of Christianity is this, that Jesus, Paul said, Jesus came to save sinners. He wants to bring all of us, he wants us to live a great comeback story. And the beginning of that is by stepping into a relationship with him. That's where it starts. We can't have that story without him. And so it's when we say yes to Jesus, when we give him our lives, that's the beginning of that comeback story. The New Testament tells us we do that in two ways. It's by turning to Jesus and trusting in him. When we turn to Jesus, it looks like this. We turn to Jesus, it's when we say, listen, I admit it, I've messed up. And I've missed out. And I have, and I do currently, and I will again, because there's something in me that's broken. And I can't fix myself. And I need forgiveness. And I need healing. We turn away from self-confidence. We turn towards Jesus. And we admit, I need you. And that's part of it. But then trusting in him. Faith is saying, I trust that you are the one to bring that salvation, to bring that healing, to bring that leadership in my life. Jesus, I give you my life and I receive your forgiveness. And I recognize that you are the rightful leader of my life. And we say that prayer. He brings us into this new life. He marks us as belonging to him. He gives us his spirit to lead us toward our own comeback story in this life, here and now. If you want that, it's just one heartfelt prayer away. So this morning, I want to give you that opportunity. It's a personal decision, though. So I want to ask if everyone in the room would just bow your heads and close your eyes and just let this be a sacred moment. Don't move around. Don't pack up. Just take this moment. I'm not going to ask you to stand up or to come forward. I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand as a symbolic gesture to God, saying, yes, I want to have you. I want to invite you into my life. This morning, if you say, I want to get right with God, I recognize that I can't fix myself. I want to invite Jesus. I trust that Jesus is the one who can rescue me, who can heal me and lead me towards the story that he has for me. And I want to invite him into my life. If that's you, just raise your hand. Yes, yes, yes. I'll see the hand and I'm just going to pray for you. So I want to invite Jesus into my life. Trust you. You can put your hands down. This morning I said it's a heartfelt prayer. So I'm going to pray, but God is responding to your heart. And so as I pray, I want you to, I'm inviting you just to repeat the words after me, but God's responding to you. If you're a follower of Jesus here already this morning, would you pray with us so we don't have to pray alone? Jesus, thank you. Thank you for coming to earth, showing me how much you love me. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. I believe that you rose from the dead. And because you did, I trust that my sins are forgiven, that I can have a relationship with you. I ask you to heal me. I invite you to lead me. I give you my life.